This is Stephen Tobolowsky, and you're listening to Fascination Street Podcast. Bing! You win!
Yeah! AV in your ears, that's Ambush Finn, giving you this audio visual down the most interesting street in the world. With my boy Steve, Fascination Street, you already know, let's get it when you whip in the Fascination Street.
Welcome back, Streetwalkers. This episode is a return appearance. This is the third appearance by actor James DuMont. James first appeared in September of 2019, and that's where we did the whole get to know you, how did you get from where you were to where you are story. He came back again in January of 2021, and we talked about COVID pandemic and kind of the things he was doing then. And this time, we talk about his number one movie. James DuMont is in Candy Cane Lane, which is the number one movie streaming on Amazon Prime worldwide. It stars Eddie Murphy, Tracy Ellis Ross, Nick Offerman, David Alan Greer, and previous guests of Fascination Street Podcast, Stephen Tobolowsky and the great James DuMont. My wife and I watched this movie the day it came out. We loved it. We've recommended it to tons of folks, and I'm recommending it to you as well. In this episode, we talk about The Righteous Gemstones. We talk a little bit about the SAG-AFTRA strike, which just ended. And then we talk about Candy Cane Lane. It's a great movie. If you guys enjoyed the first two episodes with James DuMont, you are not going to be disappointed in this third appearance. And this is my third conversation with actor and great podcast guest, James DuMont.
Prepare to be fascinated. Prepare to be fascinated. Prepare to be fascinated.
Welcome back again to Fascination Street Podcast, James DuMont. How you doing today, man?
I'm good. How you doing?
I am fan-freaking-tastic. Ask me why.
Why?
Buddy, this is the third time you have come onto the show, and every single time before has been a blast. I expect nothing less this time.
I'll try to live up to that. Thrice blessed, as we like to say, right?
That is how I'm looking at it. Ladies and gentlemen, streetwalkers, if you will, the first time James was on was 9/15/2019.
What?
The second time was 1/25/21. So that means we had you before COVID, during COVID, and now post-COVID.
That's right.
Hopefully we can just keep on with these post-COVID ones.
I think we're done with the COVID and then we're done with the two industry strikes.
Ugh, ridiculous.
I'm ready to get back to work. I got my first offer today, which was nice. I haven't had an offer in quite a while. We're back.
Was this an offer, no audition? They just a straight offer?
Yeah. Going into COVID with Spencer Confidential about to drop, The Banker having gone to the Oscars and invited to Vanity Fair, I felt like the trajectory of where things were going was like, what? This is a lot of hard work. You know, when I was at the Spencer Confidential premiere in March of 2020, I'm wearing my red tracksuit with Scott Stuber, the head of, you know, Netflix. And I came out of the theater and it was like 400 people just surrounded me and all wanted selfies. And I lean over and I look at my manager and my manager's just smiling from ear to ear. My sister's there. And he's just like, lean into it, man. You're a 30-year overnight sensation. You know, so it's one of those kind of like, I'm sure everybody's going to have their pre-COVID, post-COVID story of like, man, things were going and then COVID hit, you know, like I said that I didn't want to be that guy, you know, but if I really look at it, yeah, that was just like an amazing kind of time. And then the fun part for me is 3.5 years later, I'm at the same theater. I'm with my sister and I'm on the red carpet. I'm in Candy Cane Lane. I'm in, you know, like the number one worldwide movie on Amazon right now, the most streamed thing on Amazon, you know, Eddie Murphy, family Christmas comedy. It's like, check that box, you know? And so it was just nice to be back. This is the one and only job I had in 2023. So, you know, the fact that I shot it the last 2 days of shooting in March, and then here I am, the premiere in December, it's just kind of miraculous. I was telling a dear friend, you got to stick around. You know, I mean, I've been on the health kick, but now I'm on a serious health kick. Like I've dropped 20 pounds. I'm eating clean. You know, I'm trying to sleep as much as I can, because I'm really at mid-career right now, which is a weird thing to say when, you know, I got my SAG card in 1980 from the Blues Brothers, you know, and I'm mid-career 40 years later. So what's the next 40 years going to be like? And 40 years, I'd be Norman Lear age. but you go, look, when you see a guy like that, you're like, now that's a benchmark. That's a life well lived and a legacy left behind. That there was a whole video on Instagram about 100 years from now, somebody's going to be living in your house. Your car's going to be scrapped. You're just going to be this photograph on a mantle, the great grandfather, you know what I mean? If you're lucky. And so it's like, I have so much joy and appreciation and gratitude being able to do what I want to do and still tell stories as the cavemans did when there was no words. It's still important. And I think it's an essential worker. I mean, not to the point of doctors, nurses during COVID, but what did people do during COVID? They binged watched and listened to music and art. And we needed those human stories to remind us, like, oh my God, we're all facing this world pandemic together. It's just interesting. I've been kind of just waxing fantastic about kind of where things are at now. And I'm really excited about what is ahead. And that the fact that, you know, I'm finishing the year with a movie offer when in 2020, half my work was, you know, in 2019 even, I had half offers and half audition. I'd like there to be more offers, but I'm willing to do a job interview if the role is right.
I agree. Back to people's COVID stories. I don't think I have shared my COVID story professionally on here yet. So back, you know, right around that time, Spotify was just dumping millions and millions of tens of millions of dollars into podcasting. They gave Joe Rogan $100 million. Hell, they gave Dax Shepard $60 million. Well, they were going to give me $10 million, but then COVID happened. And I'm just kidding. Wouldn't that be cool, though?
That would be a good story. Even if they give you $1 million, you just take a zero off of that, it still would be good.
Yeah, I'll take it. Spotify, I know you're listening.
Yeah.
Holla at your boy.
Exactly. Holla, 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 can I holla? And the good news is you have the content. That's the thing.
Yeah, I'm coming up on 400 episodes, man.
Yeah, you have the fucking content, bro. You got the goods. You got great stories. It just has to be packaged and pitched. You got the goods, bro.
I'm going to call Dax and Rogan's pitcher.
Yeah. Throw me a coin, will you? Or as we say in New Orleans, throw me some beads, mister.
Yeah. Hey, dude, I will gladly show my boobs to Spotify.
Whatever you need. I'll show my moves. If you show your moves, I'll show my boobs. I got my moves going.
Okay. So you said you're in legacy mode, basically. You're in,
yeah.
I want my work to be remembered long after I'm gone mode. What inspired that? Did you turn like a significant age? What happened?
I'm 2 years off of 60 at this point. Everybody thinks I'm like 10 years younger.
Oh, lucky you.
Yeah, exactly. I don't know. That Instagram thing really kind of hit me of like, you know, we spend so much time thinking about shit that no one will ever care about in 50 or 100 years.
So it was really that post that did it?
A little bit, just because I kind of go, well, just to kind of remind myself, like, what am I going to do while I'm here? What's next? I think the thing that it becomes so painfully obvious to actors, you know, journeyman actors as we progress along, is that if we don't have some sort of ownership or control over the content we create for ourselves with ourselves, we're missing out the big piece of the pie, because every major actor is an executive producer on the project. Now, are they active producer or is it just in credit and money? But I mean, I know people like Reese Witherspoon, you know, things that she produces, she looks at Final Cut, she looks at dailies, you know, like, are you really an active producer or is it just in lieu of what you would get paid? You're just slapping your name on that. And I did a movie with Don Johnson that's going to come out in a little while called Unit 234. Clearly, his producer credit was just for money and a bigger piece of the pie, because none of the decisions that he made on set or offset are anywhere near what I would want a producer to have. Not to bash the 80s television star Don Johnson, but I just did. Because the point is, greater actors would be on the other side of the camera for my lines. That's the real bottom line there. So for me, this kind of next phase of things is creating my own content, things that I left to take care of kids. You know, truth is, my oldest is 22, has graduated college, no debt, has a full-time job, pays their rent, is self-sufficient at this point.
No debt. Congratulations, Dad. Well done.
No debt, Cornell University, by the way. Ivy League, no debt.
Get right on out of the city.
And then to go work for another Ivy League, working for Dartmouth.
That's crazy.
Incredible success on her end. And so I don't have to worry about that right now. I mean, I'm good. And then my son, he and I are both on the Righteous Gemstones.
And have been for all of the season.
Right. We're three seasons now. They've already greenlit us for four seasons. Danny wants to go 10. You know, I turn to my son and go, the next 10 years of your life will be spent on this show, which is great because you'll have money for college and you'll be able to go to New York and do the theater you want to do. And you'll be able to afford to make choices about the kind of work that you want to do as a 20-year-old man. So for me, I kind of go like, if those things are taken care of, because that's really what I spent the last 23 years kind of dedicating myself is to being as active a parent as I can and providing money through film and television in order to put food on the table and provide some sort of support system for my kids to become independent. And so the question is, so what does James need? What do I need artistically? I created a one-man show called My Life as a DJ just before my daughter was born. Was going to go on the road, but I was like, I can't go on the road and start this journey as a dad. I don't want to be like my father and be, you know, absent. Then I created a pilot called That Guy.
Hey, you're that guy from that thing.
You're that guy. Aren't you that guy and that thing, you know? And what it's like to be in fame purgatory. You're not in heaven. You're not in hell. You're recognizable, sort of. I think there's a lot of humor and humility into, or like The Comeback, if you think about it in that regard. Like it's a little bit of a mix of those. Those are projects that I just really had to kind of shelf to just be focused on parenting, which is a full-time gig, and also just chasing work. So I feel like I'm at a point now where I'd like to start to spend more time and making use of the time that I have, putting these projects into more fruition.
My favorite That Guy story that I've heard is from Kevin Pollak. He said once that he was in an airport and somebody said, hey, what did I see you in? And he said, hey, I don't know. I wasn't with you. That cracks me up. It's a little bit of a dick move, but also so is where do I know you from?
Especially from Kevin Pollak. It's definitely a Kevin Pollak dick move, but it's apropos. I had one where I put it in my pilot, which was, is a crazy one. I was on planes forever, just chasing work and like, you know, doing everything I can to get insurance for my kids and my family. So I'm on a plane and I was one of these like Southwest flights where you're kind of fighting for those aisle seats, you know, or the exit rows. And I grab like the last aisle seat by the bathroom. And this business guy, this Texas businessman is just fucking pissed that I grabbed the seat in front of him. You know, he's got the pressed jeans and the boots, you know, and blah, blah, blah. And he's sitting in that middle seat right by the bathroom. And he's pissed because his assistant or secretary fucked up and he's got to travel, you know, Southwest middle seat. Last minute, he got on the flight, you know, kind of thing. So he sits up and he keeps looking at me. He goes, man, you look real familiar. Do I know you? And I was like, no, I don't think so. Are you my son's soccer coach? Do you coach in Abilene? And I was like, no, don't. You know, you might have done a seminar one time. I was at a conference, you know, a lawyer's conference in Dallas. You know, I'm an actor. He goes, oh, and anything I would have seen in, you know, and I'm like, yeah, I give the short list, Dallas Buyers Club and this and that, War of the Worlds, Ocean 13, Catch Me If You Can, Seabiscuit, SWAT.
Like Blues Brothers. Yeah.
And then he goes, speaking parts.
Love it. Love that.
I said, well, what kind of work do you do, buddy? Because, well, I'm a lawyer, you know, mergers, acquisitions, blah, 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 this and that. And the other. So you get coffee for everybody in the office? You do all the Xeroxing and the mimeographs of all the files, bring it down to the courthouse? Is that what you do? Dead fucking silence. Guy doesn't talk to me or look at me for the rest of the flight. Because I basically go, I just told you I'm an actor. I listed fucking 15 movies that have made hundreds of millions of dollars. But you want to fucking put me like I'm an extra. You just did a real dick move. So I'm going to just give it right back to you. You know what I mean? And man, it was a 3-hour flight, right? You know what I mean? You know, he was tight-lipped for most of the time. Of course, putting his elbow, you know, like leans his shit. You know, I say it to all my students. I'm like, don't ever let anybody disrespect you as an actor. You know, oh, you're an actor. Oh, you know, where do you wait tables? Like, oh yeah, good luck on that big break you have. You know, like all the shitty condescending things that I go, we come from storytellers, man. It's the first communication amongst humans is that somebody got a rock and grunts on a wall and told stories of the people before. Like this is a noble fucking thing. So noble that you're willing to lose billions of dollars in strike to try to make a point. You need us. You need us. If you're Warner Brothers, HBO, Netflix, Hulu, you need us more than maybe an Amazon. You need us more than maybe an Apple. They got other money. They got other revenue. But if you're a content creator and billions of hours of content were burned through COVID, and you're going to hold up $10 billion worth of film and television in order to save $2 to $3 billion, so fuck, you need us. And to try to play a game like you're going to replace us with artificial intelligence, my biggest suggestion is take the CEO's salary, create an artificial intelligence CEO, because it doesn't have to be a human being. And most of these tech companies are all about technology and law and money. It doesn't have to be a human being. Save $200 million in a CEO, turn it into an AI that figures out all the beans and all the money, right? And leave the human being stuff to the human beings on film and television. You know, like, so my biggest suggestion was, yeah, let's go AI, but let's do it with the CEOs.
Love that.
Let's take that $200 million salary. Let's put it into more great stories about human beings rather than being inhumane and hold up the entire $10 billion economy of California, who's now $68 billion in the hole. I mean, like, what are we doing? Is this how we want to spend our time on the planet? Trying to, you know, show us how powerful you are? Because it wasn't about money. You lost more money than you would have paid out to both Writers Guild and actors. I mean, like, what are we talking about?
If it's all algorithms anyway, then...
Yeah, if it's algorithms, then replace the CEO. Bob Iger is a colossal failure at Disney. Colossal.
Hi, Bob.
He's a failure diluting the brands. I mean, families don't want to take their kids to a Disney movie anymore because they don't know what the fuck is going to happen on the screen. They don't know what story is going to be told. Enough, you know? I'm not expecting any offers from Disney and Fox right now.
Hey, Streetwalkers, here's a word from our sponsors.
My Grandpa's Grandpa is an award-winning children's book. The story is that a grandfather, me, is tucking in Charlie, my grandson. Like all little children, he starts asking questions at bedtime. The questions he asks are about my grandfather. This book is a great way to think about how you can share stories of your family members with your children and grandchildren. You can order this book by going to Amazon or my website, cool-grandpa.us. If you purchase the book from my website, be sure to use the coupon code FS25 and save 25% on your order of my book, My Grandpa's Grandpa, from now until the end of the year.
Let's get back into it.
Didn't you do a Disney movie recently? Safety? Wasn't that a Disney movie?
I did Disney Plus Safety. That's the same director, Reggie Hudlin, who's directing. Brings us back to Candy Cane Lane.
See how I did that?
Reggie Hudlin directed Safety, and it was a good movie for Disney Plus. That's a good, fun story about football player has to raise his brother while he's in college in Clemson. It's a true story. And you know, it's about redemption and family. Yeah, those are some of the family values, that love and family are more important than anything. And that's one of the things, you know, why you and I are talking today. I mean, among many reasons why you and I are talking today is because they got it. Like, Candy Cane Lane is right. It's the right movie at the right time.
Nailed it, by the way. We're going to get to that in a minute for sure. My wife and I watched it the day it came out. We were very excited.
Yeah, it's fun.
Oh, real quick, as an aside, I believe that I introduced you to a guy, I don't know, over social media, maybe, named Joe Lafferty. He was like a high school football coach for a bunch of years. I think he helped coach like 11 players into the NFL, and one of them is Rob Gronkowski. You and him had like a little bit of a friendly...
Yeah, we connected for a bit. Yeah.
Yeah, I want to let you know he passed away.
Oh, dude.
I'm only telling you because you had a little bit of a relationship with him, and since he's not posting...
Yeah, we did. And I didn't know why it kind of like we were going to continue talking and try to find a way to connect. And then we just didn't connect anymore.
It was a little over a year ago. He was living in Florida, but he went back to Pittsburgh because he had some doctor's appointments. He was a transplant recipient. And so he has transplant doctors and he went back.
Yeah. No, I remember the whole story there. Yeah.
Yeah. He went back to go have like, I don't know, his pacemaker adjusted or something like that. You know, he was staying at his mom's house and he was there for the weekend helping her clean out the garage. And then one day after he got his pacemaker adjusted, he woke up in the middle of the night, just I guess long enough to fall off the bed and curl into the fetal position and then die. Like that was it. It was very sudden.
How old was he? About
51, maybe 50, something like that. Wow. Oh, man. He was one of my best friends. He was a dear, dear man, and I miss him every day.
We should figure out a way to tell his story, man.
It's not hard. He wrote a book.
Dude, I know some people that would turn that into a movie, and I'm not kidding.
I'll send you the book.
Send me the book, dude. I'm working with the people, same people did Safety. I'm trying to get them on this boxing movie that I have that's, you know, really cool, true story. And my buddy works with the development people over there. They're stacked up with stuff, but that's their niche. They do sports related film. They're doing the one with Michael Chiklis right now, the senior.
Oh, cool.
You know, where a guy goes back and finishes college in his 50s. It's a great, great, cool story.
I think you should play Chiklis in the movie about Chiklis. I think you should play him in his life story.
Yeah, I should. Exactly. He and I are like college buddies, by the way. Did we talk about this?
I don't know. We might have. I don't think so. But you should definitely play Chiklis in the movie about, you know how they did the movie? Like, I think it was called The Room or whatever, where they made the movie about the movie.
Yeah.
When they make the movie about Wired, you should play Chiklis.
Oh, dude, the stories about Wired. I was there for all of that. He had moved to New York and bartending his restaurant in Soho. I was at his engagement party. I mean, like many tears and many fucking pissed off punching in walls over the shit that he went through. And to be blackballed for so long. I think finally Aykroyd kind of made some sort of peace with him, but Dan made him public enemy number one by doing that story. And he was just a guy out of college just trying to fucking make a living, you know? And, you know, who wouldn't take on the opportunity to play John fucking Belushi? I mean, are you kidding me?
I mean, seriously, I would do it and I can't act.
Yeah, I know that story. That would be very funny, actually. Chick was attached for a little while to this pilot that I had, you know, and then he got pulled into this other TV series that my friend Chris Moncato is doing, which is like in the 80s kind of Cuban cocaine hotel kind of story. Because, you know, Chris does Godfather of Harlem. And then the other one is Narcos.
Oh, shit.
He and my buddy Danny Pino. So Chiklis and Pino are in Canada doing that thing now. They went
Pino?
From, yeah, Danny Pino.
No way. From Mayans?
Yeah, bro.
Oh, my God. I love that guy. He's so rad.
Dude, Danny, I was just texting him just the other day. Like,
oh, yeah. Well, text him and give him my phone number. That dude's amazing.
He's
oh
amazing, God, dude. So he's cool. An amazing guy and a beast of a worker. He just, every time I turn around, Pino's doing something. So, yeah, I got this pilot that I had Chiklis on. I think Danny is more right age-wise and type-wise for the lead. So I'm sending Danny the script stuff. So we're trying to get that going.
Sweet.
Yeah.
I will send you Joe Lafferty's book.
That'd be great.
It's a great book.
Yeah.
I want to talk about Righteous Gemstones real quick.
Yeah, I can always talk about Righteous Gemstones.
So 3 seasons in the books.
Yep.
You got another one greenlit. Danny wants to do it forever. Danny McBride wants to do it forever.
He does.
That show looks like every single day on set is Mardi Gras. Like, how much fun is it to work?
It is. I say to people, like, my biggest analogy to it is, it's like coming home for Thanksgiving and you have a healthy family, which is a rare thing.
So it's not like coming home for Thanksgiving at all.
But some crazy shit's going to go down. You do have the drunken uncle. There's going to be the molesting uncle and the drunken uncle. There's going to be some shit. So you got to be prepared for whatever goes down. And the fact that my son and I are on the show together, it makes it even doubly a miracle for us because we spend 6 months a year in Charleston, you know, on the show. And Danny treats him like his own son. And John treats him. John lives in New Orleans. We live in New Orleans. So, you know, John lives in the same city we do when he's not in LA doing the Connors. It's very much like a family, but a crazy family. And then the joy for me is that each season gets crazier.
It's Danny McBride. So, yeah.
It's Danny McBride. My son's trajectory storyline for Pontius this last season was ridiculous. And they keep turning him going, oh, dude, wait till you see what's ahead. Like, they already know where they want to take my kid. They've teased me a bit saying, you're going to finally have a scene with Pontius. You know, Chad and Pontius are going to be in the same scene together. I'm like, we've been in scenes together, but we never interacted. So they made a little promise to me for that. So that I'm excited about that possibility. But yeah, lucky for us, we got a verbal kind of green lit from Danny when we finished 3 that it's looking good. Once we did the premiere, we premiered 3 at ATX Festival in Austin, which is a great festival for you to go to. That's the new Sundance in terms of television. Be great for you to do your podcast from there. You know, you should talk about that possibility. But yeah, so we went to ATX, and at ATX, you know, I turned to both Danny and I also turned to David Gordon Green. And I was like, are we good? You know, there's like this new ownership and I don't know. And they're talking about a strike. And you're like, no, we're good. We're good. And so they end up turning in the scripts to HBO a full week or a month before the strike happened. So, and then the next day, HBO made it official that we were greenlit for season four. So we got another 9 episodes that are coming up. Usually my son average between 4 and 6 episodes. So, you know, half the season. So we're looking forward to it. Usually there's a 6 months of pre-pro. So I don't think they started building the sets yet. And we're on December. Usually it's 6 months out from when they start building the sets and pre-production. So my guess is probably May, June, 2024.
Love it.
There is talk about maybe trying to shoot 2 seasons at once because of John's schedule on Connors and Walton Goggins. Pretty busy schedule for film and television. So we don't know. We know that they're super organized and they can do that. They did with the vice principals. They did 2 seasons in 1 pass. So it's possible, but we'll see.
That is a scheduling feat.
Oh, yeah, dude. But again, you got a Danny McBride machine.
Right.
You have groups of people that have been working together for 20 plus years. Some of them crew guys they were in college with at North Carolina School for the Arts. It runs like a fine-tuned machine. But I think the joy for me is that the master shots are as scripted, medium are scripted, and then there's a little bit of improv. But then we get to the close-ups. We're punching in. We're improvising stuff. Crazy things are whispered in either of our ears about, well, why don't you try this or say this line? You know, and you're, as you say it, you can see the entire crew on the other side, you know, covering their mouths. And then when cut happens, everybody's cracking up, including, you know, the extras and the audience. So there is this almost like a locker room kind of fraternal game afoot. You know, how much can you say or how much can someone say or do in front of you? And can you keep a straight face and not crack up? You know what I mean? Like the outtakes that you see are like, you know, with Danny McBride outtakes or like with Will Ferrell or Craig Robinson, you know, like I'm going to say all kinds of crazy things in front of you and see if you break, you know, like, so there is that kind of challenge. And my son and I remind ourselves all the time, not only are these like probably the heaviest hitters in terms of comedy, in terms of sketch and improv, but they're just really good people. Like Cassidy treats Kelton like his son. Now she's a new mom. We really treat each other very well. A lot of it has to do with Danny McBride. I always feel it works from the top down. If you have a power hungry, egotistical, maniacal producer who usurps power and treats everybody according to what he needs that day or she needs that day, that kind of philosophy runs rampant in there. Everybody's on a power trip because this person's on a power trip.
Talking to you, Tommy Lee Jones.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. But if you set the tone of we're all creating this incredible thing together, so every single person is important, the caterer, craft services, the van guy, Danny talks and deals with every single person. Everyone is accessible to him. And everything you think what's great about Danny McBride is even better than you imagine.
I got to imagine with Danny McBride, you know, HBO giving them the green light. I feel like he's in the Larry David sphere, right? Like he can pretty much do whatever if he wants another season, he can do another season. If he doesn't, he won't.
That's right.
If the door's open, I mean, took 20 years for Larry David to come up with 10 seasons of Curb Your Enthusiasm, 20 years. And they're just like, hey, whatever you want to do, whenever you're ready. And I feel like that's probably the same agreement they have with Danny McBride.
I think so too.
Because he brings it.
Yeah, because he brings it and the audience just keeps building. It's like we go from like 4 million to 5, 9. The last one was 11 million viewers. That may not mean much in big network, but 11 million viewers collectively. And also now this new binge culture and mentality of like, I'm going to watch the whole season. We drop them weekly, which I still like that idea of like the taunting and the teasing. Many huge fans have said wholeheartedly, they've watched all 3 seasons multiple times. You may not be getting the same kind of network bang at once for ad revenue, but the reality is that there's a following, there's an audience. And he has this kind of like blue collar NASCAR fraternity. He's got an audience.
Yeah. I think his audience is people who want to laugh.
Yeah.
They're not looking to disassemble any joke. They're not looking to figure out who's offended by what.
Correct.
They just want to laugh.
That's exactly right. No, he just says each episode should be its own contained story. You should be able to pop in on any gemstone episode and get what the essence of what we're doing. Each one should be its own contained little movie.
Love it.
I also think that the thing, Danny and I were talking about this because I go, dude, I'm just marveling at all that you've created right now, you know, or collectively. And he goes, what do you mean? I was like, well, you know, Eastbound and Down The stories lived and died by Kenny Powers. It was all Kenny all the time. That nothing could happen with or without Kenny. Like, it had to happen. And then when you got vice principals, you kind of split the focus between you and Walton, and then the two of you guys pairing up together again. But now with Gemstones, you've created this family tree, this ancestry, this lineage. You're going back in time. Now you're doing flashbacks to people. Now their ghosts are coming. You could do an entire season on baby Billy Freeman. So you're hands in, you're not hands on, which is great because you're in the scene, but you're also kind of directing. I mean, the brilliance of figuring out that he's took all the power that Danny does and he shares it with everybody else so that other people can kind of shine. That's the mark of a genius, in the sense that maybe it became about him in order to get that kind of brand and get that audience kind of built. But then now any of these storylines, you could go anywhere with these characters and we would go with you. I think the challenge that they have in the editors too, it's like, there's so many outtakes. There's so many amazing choices. And I got really lucky in the sense that each one of the guys in the Goon Squad, like, they just thought the Goon Squad was going to be one or two episodes. And each one of us brings our A game because we see who's around us and we go, I have to meet or match these motherfuckers, you know, like Adam Devine, Tony Calvera, Cassidy, Edie Patterson. Holy shit, you got to try to keep up with Edie Patterson? That's like next level Jim Carrey shit. So what's beautiful about the show is that it rises your game. And then when I get to do things like Candy Cane Lane, it's like, I'm good. Tracy Ross and I, we could do a whole show on our relationship between Donald and Carol. She's coming off three camera. I'm coming off Danny McBride doing three camera, six camera, improv. It's been an incredible training ground. And my son too, like, watches John's work. And he's like, you know, John never does the same take twice. He never does it the same way. And I go, no. And he goes, each time he does something different. And they never give him a note or adjustment or anything. And I go, that's because he's John Goodman. And they know John's going to give you three or four different choices. Let the editors figure out what. So the editors come up to us and they're like, you guys, you don't understand. Like, we argue and we fight over our favorite Goon Squad moments because you guys do all this crazy shit to the point where Danny's like, yeah, yeah, cut to the goons over there. And again, he's giving us the freedom and they're creating a platform to let everybody shine. It's so anti-Hollywood that we're in Charleston. It's so anti-Hollywood where it's every man for himself. We're all in this together. So it's like the show works because he sets the tone.
I love it. Danny McBride, you heard it here last. You are a genius.
Yeah, you are. It's true. I'm not the only one that thinks that, that's for sure.
Oh, absolutely.
Hey, Streetwalkers, here's a word from our sponsors.
This holiday season, give the gift of an unforgettable story. Rise of the Unicorn by D. Eliot Woods is a chart-climbing crime suspense thriller that's opening eyes and winning hearts. With unexpected twists and a powerful message, you can find it on Amazon, Audible, and iTunes as an audiobook, and it's available in paperback and ebook formats on all major platforms. Even more exciting, it's narrated by the author. Gus turned to the camera. What do you want? Let's skip the games. What do you want? The speakers again came alive.
We want our questions answered. What is more valuable than money?
Make this season memorable with a gift they'll cherish. Rise of the Unicorn by D. Eliot Woods.
Merry Christmas and Happy New Year!
Let's get back into it.
Now we're going to talk about Candy Cane Lane, my man.
Let's do it.
I think it came out December 1st. It's on Amazon Prime Video. Eddie Murphy's first Christmas movie, I think.
Yes, it is. 100%.
The reason I know that is because friend of the show, Ron Howard, posted on Instagram, hey, we finally got Eddie to do a Christmas movie. My wife and I watched it the day it came out. We're very excited. Nowhere in the credits did I see Ron Howard's name. I only saw Brian Grazer's name, his Imagine partner. So it really struck me as genuine that even though he wasn't a listed producer on this vehicle, he was touting how proud he was to even be a tiny part of it.
Yep.
And Ron Howard, he's a nice guy, but he doesn't throw accolades where they don't need to be, if that makes any sense.
That's why he is where he is. Look, Imagine Entertainment is the producer. I mean, it is his partner. They are partners. But Brian was the main, spearheaded the project.
Sure. Candy Cane Lane, ladies and gentlemen, it's on Amazon Prime. It's free if you're a Prime member. It stars Eddie Murphy, Tracy Ellis Ross, and previous guests of the show, James DuMont and Stephen Tobolowsky.
Yes, Stephen T. One of these days, you're going to have to get Offerman on here. Nick's an old friend.
I love Nick.
I do too. And I was like bummed he was there and I was with my sister. I should have just waited at the end of the carpet. We've known each other for 30 years.
Oh, wow.
We knew each other from Chicago theater days. And he lived in my building in LA. We're part of the theater company where he and Megan met. We go back. I just can't believe I missed that opportunity because like by the time, it was all said and done, he was gone. I was like, damn it. Here I am all the way in LA. And it's like, I miss Offerman,
I don't want to give too much away, but his character throughout most of the movie is a little bit different. He mostly does voice acting for a good chunk of the movie. And I was trying to figure out who all of the people who were doing voices were. I was like, well, okay, that's Chris Redd. And I was like, who is that? And my wife said, that's Nick Offerman. And I was like, no, he wouldn't do like a British accent. He's Nick Offerman. And then it turns out I was 100% wrong. My wife was 1,000% right. It was Nick Offerman doing a British accent, which it blew me away. It fooled me.
Yeah. And he was very good. He really had a hold on that. I felt like I'm watching A Christmas Carol, it's like, hello, Governor.
Exactly.
I really felt like I'm watching Dick Van Dyke and, Chip Chip, here we go, Cheerio. Hey, hello, mate. Good day, mate. Even though that's Australian, but that's another story.
You're doing Michael Caine over there.
Yeah, like Michael Caine.
Michael Caine is the most Australian British accent in history.
Yeah, it's a pretty good one. That would be an interesting thing.
Mm-hmm. Back to Nick Offerman for just a hot second.
Let's keep talking Nick.
Sure. You guys are friends. I don't know if you have seen his episode of Hot Ones, that Hot Wing show thing.
Uh-huh.
He is hilarious. I love everything he's done. Even his interviews are awesome. But that Hot Ones episode is one of my favorite things that Nick Offerman has ever done. Some of the things when you, like, let's just say Parks and Rec, whenever he says something that you're supposed to laugh, he looks directly at the camera, right? This one, he was just throwing him out there left and right. Like, it didn't matter if it landed or not. And I was in stitches. If you haven't.
Now, I'm definitely writing it down because I'm watching that. So Hot Ones, Nick Offerman. Okay.
Yeah, Hot Ones, Nick Offerman. It is one of the best episodes of that. And also, it's like I said, it's one of my favorite things he's ever done. Streetwalkers, go check that out. It's awesome as hell.
We actually did an episode of Arliss together.
Get out of here. How old are you?
Yeah, dude, we were young. We did an episode of Arliss together where we were cheeseheads. We're both from Chicago and like hardcore Cubs and Bears fans. So we signed on to be these two like crazed fans. And the guy that we attacked was Michael Clark Duncan from the Green Mile, dude.
Oh my gosh, that's nuts.
I ran into Robert a few times. He goes, you and Offerman, you're like, you guys are fucking killing it. Blah, blah, blah. He goes, you were on our show. And I was like, dude, I remember. And he's like, how can we not forget Michael Clark Duncan? And then we just took a moment, put our hands on each shoulder, man, because Michael's from Chicago. He studied with my teacher, Larry Moss. Another buddy of mine was in the same class and he had told him, you should audition for this thing. And, and then for Michael to pass, it just fucking broke our hearts, man. It broke our hearts. He was just the kindest, gentlest giant you'd ever fucking meet. A great dude. And Nick Offerman and I, we had a fucking blast. And I was like, we worked with an Oscar. And I'm like, this is our thing. It was one of the earlier gigs that Offerman did when he first got to LA. The fact that we ended up doing it together and living in the same building, that was just ridiculous. So yeah, it's an old episode of Arliss called Fans First, if you're an HBO subscriber. And it was Michael Clark Duncan. And I had great stuff with Jim Turner, who then was in Gemstones as BJ's father. So that was like a weird kind of like circle thing. It's one of those things where it's like, I always say to everybody, I'm like the Forrest Gump of actors, I just kind of show up in these little, there's James. Oh, what's he? Friends of mine go to like Peru or they're in Japan or, hey man, I'm in Japan And there is Catch Me If You Can, you know, subtitles, should have been a pilot. I'm working with my editor right now. We're trying to do what we call the kitchen sink reel, where we just throw all my shit in one, just everything in there.
Oh my God, how long is that going to be? Holy shit.
Well, I'm just going to pick the best stuff.
Oh, okay. Yeah, sure.
And then in the end, I have this idea of like throwing music under and just all these clips, the little posters of each of the shows. It's like, you know, just to go bam. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
As my manager would say, I'm a 30-year overnight sensation.
Love it. Again, Candy Cane Lane, ladies and gentlemen, is the number one movie on Amazon Prime right now, worldwide.
Worldwide.
Worldwide. Tell me about the party.
Yeah.
The strike ended, and then, boom, now everybody's allowed to go to parties and do all this crazy stuff. So what was it like to go to the Candy Cane Lane premiere party?
It was fantastic because it had been 3.5 years since the last time I was at a premiere, which was for Spencer Confidential. Same theater. I just negotiated. I always do it. I asked for 2 tickets to a premiere. I'll pay for my way to get there because I don't want them to feel like they got to put me up in a, you know, first class plane and hotel. So point being is I negotiated for the premiere and I just didn't know it was going to happen. And then all of a sudden I heard that it was, I was in New Hampshire and next thing I know we're going. So I brought my sister to the premiere, which is fantastic. I brought her to the premiere of Spencer Confidential. She's friends with Brian Grazer's wife, which I unfortunately didn't get a chance to meet, which was kind of the point. I was a little off my red carpet game.
Well, it's been a while.
It's been a while. I will say this, though. You know, one of the great things about this particular red carpet was almost all the reporters on the back end of it had seen the movie. So they knew exactly who I was and what role I played. Oftentimes it becomes very sad where my publicist pitches and they take one look at me and they're like, I don't know who that guy is. Why should I talk to him? It's like begging for change. It's a very demoralizing after doing this for so long and being in so many things. And I'm on the cheat sheet. Like it says my name, my picture, it says the credits, it said what role, but there's just some people like, I don't think it's worth the 2 minutes on my phone to interview this guy. That was not the case with Candy Cane Lane. Everybody had seen the movie. They all wanted to talk to me. A lot of Gemstones fans, which helps a great deal. And my sister just kind of sat back and just marveled at, you know, my ability to just work the room, you know. But I was a little off where I should have waited around to say hello to Nick and say hi to Tracy. And I saw Reggie, the director, at, you know, when we got into the theater. But
Nick, is that the character name or is that his real name?
Nick Offerman. I was thinking about Nick Offerman and Tracy Ellis Ross.
Got you. Because the kid who played Nick, he was in Safety with you, right?
He was in Safety as well. Yeah. TJ, he's a super kid. So that was really kind of cool to see him. Incredible spread. They had the Candy Cane Lane car there that Pepper has in the movie. Food was great. The drinks were great. To have, you know, after months and months and months of no auditions, no chance to do any acting work, you know, I taught all through the strike. It was just such a great way to kind of end the year. You know, I'm back being an actor again.
Oh, finally.
Yeah. And get to talk about certain things. People ask questions about the strike, but we stayed in, you know, mostly in Christmas mode and talk about Christmas traditions. Like my wife and I now just, you know, we've downsized into a smaller house, you know, here in New Orleans. We're going to bring back our white elephant party that we used to do when we lived in West Hollywood in California in our house. So we're going to try to bring back some good old family traditions. But yeah, the premiere was great. And the response, the audience just really dug it. I had not seen the movie. I laughed out loud.
We've recommended it to countless people. It is so much fun.
Yeah, the good news is there's jokes in there for little kids. There's jokes in there for teenagers, and there's some good adult jokes. On the family end, it's like, I think ass is the only swear word in the whole movie. There's great little moments where you go, I kind of forgot how good of an actor, and I always knew Eddie was a good actor, but some of the moments, without spoiling things, you know, when he gets hit with bad news, I mean, I was like, wow, that's a nice little heartbreaking Eddie. You know, and then it's like the Eddie we know, the fighting spirit, and I'm not going to take this shit. And like, you know, the hero Eddie that we dig. And then the lovable dad. I mean, man, what a great pairing. Tracy Ellis Ross and Eddie. Make that a show, you know.
Yeah, no kidding.
There is a little teaser at the end that gives a potential for sequel opportunities. You can see that that's happening there. And man, don't put David Alan Grier in this movie as Santa without giving him his own damn movie. I was joking on Instagram with David and Reggie and Kelly. And I was like, Kelly Younger, the writer. I was like, man, we need Candy Cane Lane 2, Electric Boogaloo, Santa's Revenge, you know, like, you know, Santa's something, somebody kidnapped Santa and, you know, Eddie's got to save him or some crazy.
Well, we know it was Pepper that kidnapped Santa.
Oh, 100%. 100%. Pepper finds a way to get back at Santa and, you know, Eddie's got to save the day, you know. So I think there's definitely a sequel possibility here, the way in which that we're kind of rolling. But what I really like is not every film or TV show that I've done is for everyone. It's not. There are some that are. Little Boy is for everyone, I think.
The Banker is for everyone. That's a great movie.
The Banker, you know, who'd have thunk a movie about banking and race would be an interesting thing.
It's so fascinating.
That was an Oscar contending movie had it not been for one particular person.
Oh yeah, who was that?
The daughter of the story who it's by.
The daughter of the story of who it's about?
Yeah.
Really?
It was about her father. She just had an angry daughter that accused another family member of sexual assault.
Oh shit.
Whether it did or did not happen, we don't know. But to not allow your father to have his moment, that's what that was about. It was really about drawing attention. And at a time where Apple was like freaking out, like, we don't know what to do. Let me tell you, bro, we were poised. Two screenings set up with the Academy. I was going to be going to all of them. Conversation with the director, conversation with the cast. We were the film on the last night of AFI, the closing film of AFI, which if you look statistically, mathematically, 90% of the time, that's an Oscar-winning film that's in the last closing night. That got pulled. We had screenings at CAA that were going to be for Academy members who couldn't make those other screens. I mean, we were poised that Samuel L. Jackson was going to get an Oscar. There's no two ways about that. And that performance in there is ridiculous. And Anthony Mackie, solid performance.
And I'll say it, James DuMont, solid performance.
Yeah, dude, I beat out some names.
Such a great movie. When you came on the screen in Candy Cane Lane, my wife goes, hey, that's that guy from The Banker. And I was like, it certainly is. And then she goes, oh, yeah, that's your friend.
That's right. Another oppressive white guy.
You played it perfectly.
Exactly. Another bureaucratic asshole.
Nice.
But not so much with Candy Cane. I think it was really, you know, it's fun. You know, I'm playing Tracy Ellis Ross's boss, which, say that five times fast.
Or once.
I did it all down the carpet. So I'd say it together. Tracy Ellis Ross's boss. Tracy Ellis Ross's boss. Tracy Ellis Ross's boss. So I practiced and everybody was like tongue twister. And it was one of the funniest things on the carpet. And she was just great. I loved working with her. I came in at the last 2 days. Eddie was wrapped by second to last day of shooting. So everybody's like, Eddie's gone. What do we do? And I was like, I just got here. Hello. You've been talking about Donald throughout the movie. Now we got to do all the Donald stuff. You know, I know everybody wants to go home and they're done. But I just got here. I'm fresh. But the fun part for me is working with Reggie Hudlin again, and we'll be working together always. Some of those shots took about 3 hours to set up because you have the conveyor belt. We're in a working, active Budweiser bottling plant in the Valley in California. Budweiser beer is still on the conveyor belts around it. You're seeing beer from on the thing. It's like, but we had to like choreograph the boxes and then the CGI with the animals and stuff. It took them 3 hours to set the shot up. I come in, knock out all my shots in 20 minutes. Boom, done. And Reggie's like, you're an assassin, but this is why we're always going to work together.
A director's dream.
Yeah, it's a director's dream. And you give me all this other stuff and we already got it. Do you want to do it again and improv some stuff? Tracy's like, yeah, let's do that. Kelly's like, I'm fine. Whatever they come up with is great. So it's like, you know, understanding what your job is and your contribution. But yeah, when you can kind of come in and be the closer in baseball and three masters, three mediums, three close, or nine strikes to get out of the inning, man. And people have been there for 9 months and it's a 10-hour, you know, it's the end of the day. You come in and close and do all your work. People like you. It gets you some job security. I can tell you that.
Love that. Oh, James DuMont. The third time, bro. That's a pretty elite group of people.
Three times a charm.
That's right.
The trifecta.
Holler. Everybody, once again, go check out Candy Cane Lane. It is the number one streaming movie on Amazon Prime worldwide. It is a great holiday movie. This is a movie people are going to watch every year for the rest of eternity. I think so. It is fantastic. Yeah. As we're heading out, man, is there anything we didn't talk about or I didn't ask you about that you wanted to talk about?
Unit 234 is going to be coming out. So when we kind of get to that, we'll cross that bridge when we get to it. I have a really nice supporting lead role opposite Don Johnson, playing his bodyguard, you know, henchman driver. It's a great thriller directed by Andy Tennant. And then we got Isabel Furman in there, you know, from the Orphans movies, like really fantastic. And then Jack Houston. And that's just a really cool project. It's a great little thriller. Well done. Shot it for 6 weeks in, get this, Grand Cayman Island, Bahamas, baby.
No way.
Oh, yes. Yeah, 6 weeks. And we did night shoots. What do you think I was doing during the day?
Wow.
Beach time.
Yeah, I bet.
I have the most amazing sunset shots on my Instagram, which is James DuMont, by the way, DuMont. Yeah, it was great. That's what's coming out. And then this offer just came in, so we'll see how it goes on with that.
All the things that you didn't work on this year, I hope you work on next year.
That's the plan.
James DuMont, for the third time, dude, thank you so much for taking the time out of your busy day and your hectic Candy Cane Lane starring and partying self to hang out and let us get to know even more about you, man. I appreciate you.
Thanks, brother. Appreciate you. Have a good one.
You have a great rest of your week, man. Take it easy.
Thanks again.
And Merry Christmas.
Thank you. Merry Christmas as well.
Peace.
All right. Bye, buddy.
Bye.
Opening music is the song FSP Theme, written, performed, and provided by Ambush Vin.
Closing music is from the song Say My Name, off the 2021 album Underdog Anthems, used with permission from Jax Hollow. If you like the show, tell a friend, subscribe, and rate and review the show on iTunes and wherever else you download podcasts. Don't forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel. All the episodes are available there as well. Check me out on Vero at Fascination Street Pod and TikTok at Fascination Street Pod. And again, thanks for listening.